good morning. I know we are still gathering. When I was growing up, and my brother and sisters and I, in a little village in Nicaragua, the church was right in the middle of town. And when the bells would be rung, you knew it's time to come to church. So we would listen for them. Well, this morning, our bells are going to invite us to come to worship. Some will still be coming in, but those of us who are here, we can listen to this glorious music that calls us into worship this morning.
Thank you. to the Liturgy of Celebration on page 43, your blue hymnals. In the beginning was God, creating, giving birth to the heavens and earth. The earth was without form and in darkness. But God spoke into the emptiness, and light appeared, the dawn of our beginnings. God kept creating flowers, trees, seeds, and fruit, things that blossom and things that grow. God created more, life that crawled and life that swam, life that sprang on hooves and life that soared on wings. From the midst of this earth came yet another creature, created in God's image. There, in the bounty of the garden, God crafted humanity, male and female. God breathed into them life-giving breath. God looked upon these creatures with love and said, "It is good." Then God rested, seeing and loving what had been done, setting free this creation with all its potential for good and evil. The diversity of life is nowhere more profound than among human beings. We are many colors, shapes, and ages. Language, music, culture, and custom vary among us. We are a great tapestry woven from God's love. Artful weaver, we ask that we share your love with others, just as Jesus reached out and loved those most different from himself. Too often we fall short of this call, seeing differences as cause for fear rather than for celebration. Instead of caring for the tapestry, we unravel the fabric of your design. We perpetuate divisions by race and color, culture, class, and gender. Jesus healed the sick, fed the hungry, gave hope to the hopeless. Jesus challenges his followers to continue his ministry, asking us to feed, clothe, and give shelter, saying, as you do these things for the least of these, you do them for me. Remember the birthing of the church, when the people who had gathered for prayer and praise were filled with the Holy Spirit. We remember how the Spirit came upon them like fire, like wind, surrounding them, exciting them, opening their eyes and hearts to the power and presence of God. The Spirit-filled church could not stop, singing praises to God, reaching out to each other's need, spreading the word of God's power and God's love. We remember this beginning and pray that the church would be infused with new life through the Spirit, calling us, claiming us, summoning us to the excitement and joy of faith. Created the heavens, the earth, and life itself, may God give birth to new life in us. May God's love be known to us today through Jesus Christ. And as tiny pebbles thrown into a pond cause ripples to move outward in ever-widening circles, may our love move from this place outward, expanding to embrace our neighbors, our community, our human family, and our world.
About our church. We have a lot for seeking the Women's Fellowship assisting their annual holiday treasure sale from 8 o'clock until 12 p.m. If you're looking for that perfect gift, a unique decoration, a chicken pie, or a homemade sugar cake, this is the place to find it. Donations are welcome, and you may drop them off in the Fellowship Hall Wednesday through Friday from 10 until 4, and volunteers are needed on these days for setup and on the day of the event. Also, be sure to mark your calendars for this coming Tuesday, the 29th, for chicken pie making starting at 8:30. And don't forget, in 2 weeks from today, a blessing of the animal service will be held at 5 o'clock in the front lawn. And be sure to bring your furry, feathered, and scaly friends to receive a special blessing. Due to an insect infestation this past week, most of the rice donations for our blessing box were lost. We're looking to replenish supplies as soon as possible, so if you're out and about, please consider picking up a bag or two of rice and dropping it by the office during business hours. Additionally, Clemens Moravian Church has established a relationship with several families in Western North Carolina. They have invited us to join them in helping our neighbors recover from the devastation of Hurricane Helene. Work days are typically scheduled on Saturdays from 7 a.m. until 2 o'clock, and typically the request is for one or two sets of hands. These opportunities will be ongoing and announced with very short notice. We have a register in the Commons area if you'd like to sign up and if you're interested in this opportunity. And if you sign up, we can give a call to Clemens Moravian and let them know you're available. Now, Erin Ogburn and June have a special announcement for you.
All right. Today is Trunk or Treat. It's here. Yay! So first, the Radicals would like to thank all 27 families who signed up to decorate their trunks and hand out candy. Thank you to Kevin Olson and Rebecca Long for grilling 250-plus hot dogs for the kids as well. And thank you to Abby and Ariana and the youth for setting up games, which will be at the end of the Trunk or Treat path, where you will also be able to vote for your favorite trunks to win awesome trophies our youth designed especially for you in certain categories like the creepiest trunk or the best in show. Winners will be announced next Sunday, so please, even if you're not coming to Trunk or Treat to get candy, come out and check out the trunks and vote. And finally, I want to thank everyone for their treat donations. I'm going to go through the logistics really fast because this is a captive audience. So, as of Monday, we pre-sorted 13,611 pieces of candy. That's enough for 250 kids. We also have 1,431 toddler snacks, so that's enough for 53 toddlers. And we continue to receive donations. That may not be enough. We just don't know. So if you brought candy, I saw people dropping it off, feel free to bring it. We can always use it. Y'all, that's over 15,000 individual treats for the kids. And that doesn't include all the stickers and tattoos and other prizes that people dropped off. So thank you so much. Quick logistics. Those who have a trunk, please, please plan to park in this lot. The lot with the Boy Scout hut, the preschool office, and church entrance by 4 p.m. We're going to close the lot no later than 4:15. There will be spots marked with X's, and that's intentional because with 27 trunks, it's actually going to be hard to fit everybody in a way that works. So we're going to mark the spots. So please, please mark park on an X. Don't make your own spot because you'll prevent other people from having a space. And I have a diagram, so if you have questions, you can ask me. It's really ridiculous. We will bring you your first round of candy before 5. I know some of you have it, but some of you don't. We will bring candy around before 5. Everyone else, no matter your age, parent, grandparent, aunt, uncle, or just one of the many amazing people in this church who love our children and love our church, you are all invited to come. Please come. It starts at 5 and ends at 7. Please park in this lot by God's Acre in the Fellowship Hall. Please try to enter off of Kilpatrick. Please don't come in the country club entrance because you're just going to be aiming toward the trunk or treaters and kids will be walking. Please come in off of Kilpatrick if you can. Walk around the front of the church, and you're going to enter right here where this sidewalk by the giant tree is. That's the entrance. And it's going to be marked off in an easy flow to keep the children safe. Children, bring your buckets. Adults, bring your cameras. And cheers for everyone's creativity, and costumes for everyone are strongly encouraged. Thank you for making this event so special for my children and all of the full table of children over here who are just wonderful. Thank you.
And now we have Charlotte Henshaw with us this morning to tell us about an exciting
the kiddos. So for those of you who don't know me, I've been singing in this church's choir since I was very little. Singing in the children's choir was something that I looked forward to every single Sunday afternoon, which is why I'm going to be starting children's choir back up again. So starting next Sunday at 4, you can bring your little ones to the choir room and we will sing some songs. I'm hoping that we can learn a few songs to perform for Love Feast during Christmas. I really hope to see people there. Thank you.
This week, we would like to tell you about some additional opportunities available for the 12 days of service. Come help us dress up lambs on December 9th. For many years, New Philadelphia has attached a message of love and support to these cute little critters. There they are. These lambs are available for pickup at any time, and we encourage you to send them to anyone who may need a lift in their spirit. But before they are sent out into the world, they need their tribes and boats. That's where you come in. We are asking for a small group to join us in the library from 9 until 11 to ready these lambs for service. Every month, we deliver a meal and some friendship to our homebound members. During this Christmas season, we would like to send a little extra cheer. We are asking for 6 bakers to each bring in 2 dozen of their favorite homemade cookies at 11 o'clock on Wednesday, December 4th, so they may be sent along with our open door delivery. And as part of our 12 Days of Giving project, we will be taking donations of toilet paper for Sunnyside Ministries. SNAP and WIC programs don't cover paper products, so our collection will help support a gap in these systems. Donations will be taken in the common area on December 1st and 8th. And now, Catherine Teague is here to tell you about our new take on the Alternative Giving Project.
In May of 2023, I was diagnosed with stage 2 metastatic breast cancer. Before I had my surgery in July of 2023, I had to have extra testing. Some of those tests were not fully covered by insurance, so I had to pay out of pocket expenses. I was fortunate that I could afford these costs. There are those who can't afford to pay for these tests and still pay for daily things such as utilities, rent, food, transportation, and to the cancer treatments, and the list just keeps on going no matter what. That's where the New Philly Cancer Benevolence Fund comes in. It can provide some of those needed funds. On December 8th, as part of the 12 Days of Giving, you will be able to contribute to the Cancer Fund. You will see it set up in the Commons area for that. And the Cancer Fund is not a budget item for the church. It depends on gifts from you. Please prayerfully consider giving on December 8th. I'm cancer-free now and have been blessed by this congregation and by many prayers and much love. Thank you. I can feel these prayers and love during my surgery and treatment.
And now we have Ashley with an exciting new opportunity for the 12 Days of Service.
Good morning. Have you ever wanted to work in Santa's workshop? Well, now is your chance. As part of the 12 Days of Service, you can sign up to volunteer for the Salvation Army Christmas Warehouse Project that I will be heading up. You get to pack and organize toys for children through the Salvation Army's Angel Tree program. It will be on December 14th from 9 a.m. to 12 p.m. You do have to be 18 or older, sorry. And there are only 12 spots available, so on November 17th when we sign up for these projects, make sure to sign up quick. Thank you.
Okay, that's it for 12 Days of Service for this morning. Michael Crane is here to speak about the upcoming blood drive.
For the past few blood drives, we've been having better and better donor turnouts. Not the donors themselves, they were already really good. But the donor turnout numbers have been better. And when that happens, the Red Cross notices and they send rewards to the person listed as the blood drive coordinator. Lately, I've been using these items as raffle prizes for those who donate blood, and to help us on the day of the drive by donating snacks or helping to staff the registration table. At the last drive, Dick Rodden won the multifunctional pocket knife toolkit with a sleek black Velcro closed carrying case. Now, his excitement over the winning this item made all of my work precious to all of these people, even better than the effort itself. And at that drive, we had a record number, at least since I've been doing this, a record number of units of blood donated at 48. We usually get around 34. So responding to this noteworthy accomplishment, the American Red Cross sent me an Amazon gift card worth $100. So get ready to feel just as good as Dick Rodden when he won his prize, because that gift card was used to purchase 2 winter coats to send to Western North Carolina. Now, that's something you should all feel good about if you were one of those 48 people who came to donate blood. If you weren't, you can help us beat that record and go closer to 50, which is about our limit. And we can send even more gifts to people in need. A pint of your precious blood is a gift that keeps on giving, and if you would like to help us break our record on November 4th, see me after the service to sign up.
And last but not least, we have Pastor Sam to tell us about a fun way to help our friends in Western North Carolina.
Good morning. On Sunday, November 17th at 5 p.m., we will be hosting, wait for it, a benefit concert for hurricane response. Some of you know that I am part of a group called the Moravian Buns. We play oldies and other kinds of music, and we've decided to have a benefit concert on Sunday, November 17th at 5 o'clock right here at the church. This morning, we are honored to have... You have one more, right? Okay. This morning we are honored to have with us the Reverend Ai Gonzalez from Cuba. She's a Moravian pastor in Hawaii Grande, Cuba, and she's married to Obispo, the Bishop Obed Martinez. And I'll just ask her to stand right now so that you can see who she is. In the Sunday school hour, Sister Alai is going to be in the banquet room sharing her story and telling a little bit about the church in Cuba so that that can be recorded to be shared with others. If you are available during the Sunday school hour, you're certainly willing to come down there to the banquet room as well. This morning, we remember in our prayers, first of all, we remember Jan Meglith and Amy Guthrie on the passing of their brother David last Sunday. And we remember all of the family members. Also, on Friday evening, our dear sister Iola Lewis passed away. She had been at Salem Town and was taken to Bermuda Village and passed away peacefully on Friday evening. There will be a visitation at the Salem Funeral Home in Old Salem on Thursday evening, and you'll get more details about that. The funeral will actually be in Aberdeen, where she is from. Also, yesterday evening, I spoke with Marilyn Aldred, and her husband Bill is now in hospice care, and we keep her and keep all of them and others in our prayers. Our liturgy mentioned ripples in a pond, and I'd like to lead us this morning in what I call a ripple prayer, starting where we are and just kind of praying outward. So please join me in prayer. We start with ourselves. We take a moment to whisper in our hearts a prayer to God, thanking God for the blessings in our lives. We ask God to strengthen our relationship with God and with each other. And I ask all of you right now, just in your hearts, to lift up the main concern that you have on your heart this morning? And we pray for those around us. I know we're praying and we usually keep our eyes closed, but open your eyes a minute and just look around and lift up a prayer in your heart for those seated right around you. If you know their name, mention it to God. If not, God certainly does. We pray for our congregation. We pray for our province. We're thankful for the conference that was hosted here in New Philadelphia yesterday and the day before. We pray for congregations like ours who are in times of transition and in call processes. We pray for our community. We pray for our country, for those in authority and those making important decisions. We pray that God would move in our nation in a mighty way. We pray for the upcoming election that God's will might be done. We pray for our world, God's world, for places where there is division and conflict, that God would bring peace and hope and healing. And God, give us the strength and patience to continue to respond to the effects of storms and other natural disasters. We thank you, God, that we have the assurance that you have the whole world in your hands. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite the ushers to come forward for a moment. Please pray with me. God, we know we are so blessed. You bless us in so many ways. We are thankful that you offer to us this privilege, this awesome joy of sharing those blessings with others. Use our gifts and use us to spread your message of hope throughout the world. In Jesus' name. Thank you. scripture readings this morning, chosen by the man seated behind me. The first one is from Joshua chapter 6, verses 1 through 7. And in your pew Bibles, you can follow along on page 172 if you see that. Now Jericho was shut up inside and out because of the Israelites. No one came out and no one went in. The Lord said to Joshua, "See, I have handed Jericho over to you, along with its king and soldiers. You shall march around the city, all the warriors circling the city once. Thus you shall do for 6 days, with 7 priests bearing 7 trumpets and ram's horns before the ark. On the 7th day you shall march around the city 7 times, the priests blowing the trumpets. When you make a long blast with the ram's horn, as soon as you hear the sound of the trumpet, then all the people shall shout with a great shout, and the wall of the city will fall down flat, and all the people shall charge straight ahead." So Joshua, son of Nun, summoned the priests and said to them, "Take up the Ark of the Covenant, and have 7 priests carry 7 trumpets of ram's horns in front of the Ark of the Lord." To the people he said, "Go forward and march around the city, have the armed men pass on before the Ark of the Lord." Now from Matthew chapter 26. Beginning with verse 69 and reading to 71. Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. A servant girl came to him and said, "You also were with Jesus the Galilean." But he denied it before all of them, saying, "I do not know what you are talking about." As he went out to the porch, another servant girl saw him, and she said to the bystanders, "This man was with Jesus of Nazareth." Again, he denied it with an oath, "I do not know the man." After a little while, the bystanders came up and said to Peter, "Certainly you are also one of them, for your accent betrays you." Then he began to curse, and he swore an oath, "I do not know the man." At that moment, the cock crowed. Then Peter remembered what Jesus had said, "Before the cock crows, you will deny me 3 times. And he went out and wept bitterly. We remain seated and sing, "Be Thou My Vision," that's in 719 in the Blue Hymns.
Thank you. to invite the children to come down for the children's message. Good to see you all this morning. And I know a lot of you. I know Jalita. I think I know Vivian and Lydia. I know Stella. I know Eliza. I know Yoendri. I know. Oh! Jack! Guess what? Jack, can you come up here a second? Jack has a birthday today. And in a minute, we're going to sing happy birthday. I want to tell you something about Jack. He's a baseball player. He's a catcher. And he puts on a mask and all of this stuff. And he crouches down behind the plate. And I got to see him doing that. And hey, I got to tell you, he can do it. So we know each other pretty well. And I think I can say he trusts me. Do you trust me? Good answer. Okay. You trust me. Jack, I've got here. I have some eggs. I have 3 eggs. Now, here's the deal. One of them is boiled, and 2 of them are not. Now, would you trust me if I say, I'm going to get the one that's boiled and crack it on your head? This is the correct answer. Yeah? You know, let me see. Okay. If it's not boiled, what would happen? Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you for trusting me. Now, you could be thinking, no, they're all hard-boiled. Here, hold this. Watch this.
Oh, no.
I don't do this every Sunday. Little details. So, thank you, Jack, for trusting me. You know that sometimes God calls us, wants us to do some really good things, but we have to trust God. And we trust God because we know that God loves us. And God knows us, and we know God. Now, if some stranger were to come up here and say, hey, can I crack an egg on your head? He might have said, I don't know. But we know each other. And when we know God, we know that God loves us. And God gives us the best that we trust in God. Let's pray, and then we're going to sing happy birthday to Jack. Dear God, we thank you that we can trust you. Thank you that you love us so much. You know us, and you love us. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, here we go. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jack. Happy birthday to you. Thank you. Now, you all can go to children's birthday. All right, okay. We will sing for you for sure. Okay, we'll do it.
Thank you.
will take a minute, but just bear with me. It's estimated that there are about 2.4 billion followers of Jesus in the world today. Of course, we can't know their hearts, their sincerity, their commitment to Christ, but it's safe to say that millions and millions, yes, even billions of people not only know Jesus, but actually love Jesus and follow Jesus. About 2,000 years ago, Jesus called 12 men to be his disciples. They walked with him and learned from him, and there were many women who followed Jesus. One woman was the first to go and tell others in the village about Jesus, and another woman was the first to announce the news that we proclaim every Easter morning, the Lord is risen indeed. So how did we get from that little band of imperfect, incredibly human beings to a worldwide movement with billions of followers? Two words, I believe. Relationships, discipleship. A person would come to know Jesus and enter into a loving relationship, then they would tell others, they would invite others, they would learn from Jesus, and they would share what they learned with others. There's a formula that I like to call 2T22. That's because it's found in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 2, where an older man named Paul, who had heard about Jesus and had come to know Jesus, spent time with a young man named Timothy, and taught him and shared with him and wrote to him saying, "What you have heard from me through many witnesses, entrust to faithful people who will be able to teach others as well." I have the joy of doing that here at New Philadelphia. The joy of following the example of Jesus and the Apostle Paul and many others. A few months ago, a young man named Ryan McReynolds, a couple years ago, had come to me asking about the possibilities of teaching from this pulpit. And then another young man named Noah Macemore, whom I had gotten to know in other ways, came to me and said, "I'd like to share a sermon. I have a message to share." Now, listen. And I heard that he had something important to share, the importance of listening to God's call and trusting God above all else. Yesterday, I texted Ryan to tell him that Noah is preaching this morning. And he texted me back after App beat Georgia State yesterday. "That's awesome!" 2 exclamation points. I'll be sure to tune in. And I hope all of you will tune in and receive this message from Noah so that you can share it with others.
Good morning, everyone. So I'd like to get a show of hands how many people have told by their parents at least one time in their life, "Please trust me on this," or something. I mean, I have plenty of times. So we put our trust in them, but like, we can't always put our trust in ourselves or other people or our parents or our friends. We have to put our eternal trust in Jesus. There's so many instances throughout the Bible of this happening. I mean, you can go from all the way from the beginning to the end of the Bible. Our first example today comes from Numbers chapter 13, verses 17 through 20. Moses sent them to spy out in the land of Canaan and said to them, "Go up to the Negev and go up in the hill country and see what the land is, and whether the people who dwell in it are strong or weak, and whether there are few or many, and whether the land that they dwell in is good or bad, and whether the cities they dwell in are camps or strongholds, and whether the land is rich or poor, and whether there are trees in it or not. Be of good courage and bring some of the fruit of the land. Now is the time of the season of the first ripe grapes." Let's continue on in Joshua chapter 6, verses 6 and 7. As we read earlier, Joshua had been told by God to send the people to go strike Jericho and to be able to bring the walls down so they could conquer that piece of land which was promised to them. Earlier in Numbers, they did not trust God, so they did not go to the land. God made them stay in the land, in the wilderness, for longer. After they had trusted God back in forward to Joshua, the walls fell, and they were taken up by the land. Eventually, they had gained that full part of the land. We skip back a little bit into the first couple chapters of Exodus, right after Moses had been exiled into the wilderness surrounding Egypt. Moses had been approached by God through the burning bush and had been asked to go release his people from slavery in Egypt. Moses had given so many excuses, saying, "I can't do it, I can't speak, they won't listen to me." And each and every time, God gave him a full and thought-out response. He, as in Moses saying that he can't speak, he gave him Aaron, his brother, to speak for him. He said, they won't believe me, and they won't be my miracles. So God gave him a staff that he could put down as a serpent and pick that right back up. Because he had been so trusted in, he went on into Egypt and told Pharaoh to let people go. Time after time again, Pharaoh said, no, I will not let you go. Eventually, after the 10th plague, he let them go. As they were leaving, Pharaoh said to them that he wanted them back, and that he was either going to go kill them or bring them back into slavery. But because they trusted God, God gave them protection within the wall of fire and the closing and opening of the Red Sea. We skip forward a couple thousand years into Matthew. As we read earlier, Peter was standing around a fire, trying to warm himself after denying Jesus had betrayed. He was standing around a charcoal fire, and a servant woman came up to him and asked him if he was a follower of Jesus. He denied Jesus, and he said, I do not know him. And he still did this two more times before the rooster crow. We skip forward a couple days right after the resurrection. We skip forward to a morning where Peter was cooking fish and feeding. Well, actually, he was fishing for fish in the morning. As he was rowing back to the shore, he saw a man on the beach cooking over a charcoal fire some breakfast. As he got closer, he realized that it was Jesus immediately, and he rushed to him and told his other men to bring the fish and to cook it. As they were eating breakfast, Jesus asked him three times, do you love me? And each time Peter replied with, yes, I love you, Lord. And each time after that, Jesus responded with, feed my lambs for the first one, tend to my sheep for the second one, and feed my sheep for the third one. He turned this example of Peter turning away from God and rejecting him, as he said, earlier in the passage, he swore that he did not know Jesus. The example of the charcoal fire is only mentioned in Luke. It's only mentioned twice throughout the Bible, or else Luke, within the charcoal fire. Jesus turned that charcoal fire that was a symbol of fear and rejection and untrust into something of trust, redemption, and praise. He can do that for all of us. There's so many ways that people can take something that's completely bad and honest and change it into something that's so much better for them. Without trusting the Lord, we will fail. If we put our trust in other things, such as man or sin or ourselves, our faith will waver because we don't have a solid rock on which we can stand. Because Jesus is the solid rock on which we stand. Our trust in Jesus keeps us strong and our faith firm. Without him, everything crumbles. If the Lord calls us, we have to answer with yes. Here I am, Lord. Which brings me to pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for bringing us here today. We thank you for just the weather we're having today, the rain that we desperately needed. We thank you for the ability to gather together and praise you. We pray for those in Western Church, North Carolina, who have been harmed by the storms. We pray for those who are just in need of you and maybe need your guiding touch and the ability to trust you. We thank you for giving us the trust that we need to keep going forward. And we praise you for everything you do. Amen. Would you please open up your hymnals to the Lord of Sea and Sky, located on whichever one says in your bulletin.
I am the Lord of sea and sky. I am the Lord of sea and sky.
you do the same and use me for a specific purpose? Noah challenged us and said that what we need to say is, here I am. So I want you to think when you're lifting your hand that you're really raising your hand and saying, here I am, Lord. Now, one more thing. I'm going to put someone on the spot. Hermana, disculpe, pero yo creo que como está aquí, tiene que darnos la bendición. Y si puede pasar para ofrecer la bendición final en español. She's going to offer the benediction, asking God's blessing on us here this morning. Sister,
Señor les bendiga y le guarde. Que el Señor haga resplandecer su rostro sobre cada uno de ustedes y les dé la paz.